We're going to continue the conversation that we had yesterday about pitching stories. And we thought we would role model for you a conversation, the kinds of conversations an editor might have with you about your story. And so we're hoping that in having this conversation in front of you, we'll be able to show you how you might think about framing your stories or developing your stories so that you can pitch them to editors. So I'm going to interview Robert. I'm the editor. Robert is the writer. And so, Robert, what would you like to write about?
Well, I've had this interest in a long time to write about a population of black people who live in the Canadian province of Nova Scotia. And Nova Scotia is on the Atlantic coast. It's perhaps, it is one of, it's not quite, but it's one of the most easternmost points of Canada. And Nova Scotia in the 18th century had slaves, as much of Canada did. But Canadians didn't care a lot for slavery, and they wanted slavery abolished. And then the English crown, Canada was a part of, was an English colony, and then part of the English Commonwealth. The English crown abandoned slavery too, and so they abolished slavery in Canada. But by then, Nova Scotia already had a good many slaves and people who descended from slaves, because that's where the ships landed when they came from England. In the United States, there were all these slaves who had been brought in from Africa, mostly West Africa. And when American Revolutionary War, at the time of the American Revolutionary War, many of the slaves fought on the side of the British, because Britain was not a slave nation. And so when they signed the armistice that ended the war and gave the American territories to the colonists, then one of the provisions of that is that all the slaves, the American slaves who had fought for the British, could leave the country with the British. And so the British boarded them all onto boats, and they took them to Nova Scotia. And so that increased the black population of Nova Scotia, along with the descendants of freed slaves in Nova Scotia. So today, Nova Scotia is predominantly white, it's mostly white, but the largest minority group in Nova Scotia, even more than the original natives of Canada, is people of African descent. And I found this out by meeting a young man who was from Nova Scotia when I was in Montreal on business, and I was talking to him about it, and I was kind of surprised. And he actually told me the story of about these American slaves who had been repatriated, and he was a descendant of American slaves, just as I was. So I got interested in it. I read little bits and pieces about it, and just kind of kept it in the back of my mind. And earlier this year, there was in America, they have these things called miniseries, where it will show 3, 4, 5, 6 episodes of a show on television. And there was a miniseries called The Book of Negroes that chronicled a history of African peoples in America before the Revolutionary War, before the American Revolutionary War. The United States became a country, an independent country, in 1776. So it chronicles the life of those people before the war and until many of them were boarded onto the ships and taken to Nova Scotia. So I got
Can I interrupt?
Absolutely.
You? Okay, so do you hear that this is a huge topic that he's talking about, right? There are all sorts of stories in here, right? And as somebody who writes books, as I'm listening to him, I know this could be a book, this could be a television series, this could be a movie, this could be all sorts of different kinds of projects. And so he's going to continue telling us about it, but then I'm going to try to focus him and find out what specifically he wants to write about this whole big topic, okay?
Yeah, which is actually where I need to go, because my interest in it got rekindled during this television series, and I thought I really want to know more about that. So I've read up a bit more about it, and I'm starting to learn more about it. And I really feel like the audience for there would be a large audience for it in Canada, because Nova Scotia is an important province, a lot of fishing, And I believe it has the second largest population of any Canadian province. Mm-hmm. But there is this connection between these black people in Nova Scotia to African Americans. And so part of what I want to try to explore is that particular connection and perhaps some common ancestors and beyond that. And so I actually haven't really focused it enough to determine what kind of medium I want to use, although I have considered working with a filmmaker on some type of film. That's as far as I've gotten with that.
Okay, sounds good. So in that little piece, he just gave me two really important pieces of information. So one, he just started talking about who the audience for his story might be. So why don't we start there and explore that a little bit, right? Because we want to make sure that he writes a story that connects with the audience that he wants it to connect to, right? So you were telling me a little bit about who you think the audience for your story would be.
I believe there is sort of... there are people who remain interested in the history of the slave trade in America. But... it's been a long time ago, and people have sort of lost a sense of personal connection with it, although African Americans talk about our connection to slavery. But I think if I can show this connection to black Nova Scotians and African Americans in the United States, that will generate an audience in both of those places and across Canada. Apparently a lot of the people of African descent from Nova Scotia have migrated to Montreal and particularly Toronto. Toronto is a very diverse city, and it's a big city, you know, like New York. It's a lot like New York in a lot of ways, except it's cleaner. But a lot of Nova Scotians are there. But I'm not sure that most, because I didn't realize it, I'm not sure that most African Americans realize that they have this historical connection to this group of people who live in Canada, and quite perhaps some blood relations to them as well. Mm-hmm.
So I think what I'm hearing you say is that you would like your readers for your story to be black people,
primarily
of Canadian and African descent.
Okay. And any other people who are interested in the history of the slave trade in the Americas.
Okay, so his primary audience is black people, and so that's going to inform who he pitches his story to. So he's going to be looking for publications, for newspapers, for magazines, for websites, he's going to be looking for organizations that communicate to black people as their primary audience. And if you pick up a few other folks along the way, that's fine. But mainly he's looking to communicate to black people. So that's going to be important, right? Okay. I said to you that when he started talking about the audience, there were two things that he said that I thought were significant in that little bit. He was talking about the audience, but he also mentioned in passing that this might be a collaborative project. So we know this big, massive topic that you want to cover, and we know who you want to communicate it to, but let's try to focus your story a little bit, right? So in this big, massive topic, what particularly interests you that you think would also interest this reader?
I'm thinking, and maybe I need to think about this more, but I'm thinking that if I could find a Canadian family and a U.S. family that have a common ancestor who went to Nova Scotia during that period, you know, with the British, that might be sort of a, you know, in America we call it a peg, something to relate it to. Which would take some research, but I think, you know, if the records are there, and I think some of them are, I'm thinking that's what I would like to do, is see if I can find two families on both sides of the border who have a common ancestor.
Okay.
And use those, use the common ancestor and those two existing families to as vehicles to tell the story.
Right. Okay. So we were talking about this yesterday in the group with women. We were discussing a pitch and how we wanted to tell the story. And we had a conversation about using people's stories to help you tell the story, right? So in your story, there would be a lot of what we call human interest,
right?
So in his pitch, he might say to the editor, I think what you're saying is you might be wanting to write a human interest story. Right? Because human beings are going to be the focus of it. And so I'm hearing that you're going to need to do a lot of research to identify these people.
Right.
Yeah. And that it might be a family in the United States and a family in Canada that
right.
have common ancestry or common story.
Right.
I'm thinking. Okay. So now I have a sense about their who. Okay, about the who. We're going to go through our who, what, where, when, why, right? So this is our who. And so as you think about that, what do you think you want to tell about that story about the two of them?
I think what I want to talk about is, because I'm not sure that most Black Canadians and African Americans, that you know, each knows that the other is there. Each knows that they have this common ancestry to Africa. But I'm not sure that they realize that they have this common ancestry on the North American continent.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what I want to do is try to bring that story closer to home and say, yes, we both are descendants of these people who were brought to the Americas in the slave trade, but it comes closer, the connection is closer than that, that our common ancestors lived on this continent together,
mm-hmm.
and before they were separated for whatever reasons,
mm-hmm.
and because it is very likely, as was common in slave families, that families were split apart,
mm-hmm.
when people were repatriated to Canada, because they were, and I don't know if a lot of you know this or not, but when families would be brought to the United States, and then a mother and father could have children, and literally the father would be sold to a plantation, the mother would be sold to one plantation, the son would be sold to this plantation, the daughter would be sold to this plantation. And in my family, I have relatives who have different last names, but who are very close relatives. My grandmother on my mother's side, her maiden name was Croft, and where I come from, there are a lot of people with the last name Croft. There are also a lot of people with the last name Chandler, but Gillum Croft, who was my great grandfather, and Wesley Chandler, Wesley Chandler was his brother,
mm-hmm.
and there's sort of this tradition in the South when you meet someone new, people in the United States, people say, "Who are your people?" And so one of my cousins said to me that it's not simply curiosity, that it had, you know, in some ways it has become that way because it's tradition. But people would ask that question because no matter what your last name was, if you met a boy or a girl that you liked and you were dating them, they were trying to make sure that it was not a relative. And that's why they would ask. So if your son or daughter would bring home a boyfriend or a girlfriend and introduce them, you would say to the new boyfriend or girlfriend, "Who are your people?" Because if it turns out you're a Croft and this person you've brought home is a Chandler, you're cousins. And so that's what they were trying to avoid. So I'm thinking that in the same way that families were split up in the Americas, that when in the United States of America, that when people were repatriated to Canada, that some families were split apart in the mm-hmm. same way.
So explain to me this repatriation idea. Because when I'm hearing, so you told me what you want to talk about,
right.
but I'm hearing a where, right? And so this is a story that's taking place between the United States, between I think the Southern United States, I think you're saying, and Canada.
But the boats, but I believe,
what does
I have
repatriation
to double check.
Mean?
Repatriation means that you are given a new country.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
So I think if I'm understanding you correctly, what that suggests is that some of the Black people who ended up in Nova Scotia, Canada, started out in the southern United States.
Many of them started out in the southern United States. They had made their way north, and most of the boats actually left from around Boston.
Mm-hmm. But they left from Boston to Canada.
To Canada, right? Mm-hmm. But the slaves, some of those slaves had fought in the South with Union soldiers.
Mm-hmm. So there was a war in the United States, the North, where, to make it simple, the North where there was no slavery, and the South where there was slavery.
Actually, confusing history a little bit, and let me apologize.
Yeah.
They had fought in the South with British soldiers.
Yeah.
Because the British only came so far south in the United States, but many of the slaves had escaped to the North and to fight with the British.
Okay.
Because there were Southerners who were going north to fight the British, even up around. So many of the American soldiers who died, even in upstate New York, were Southerners. So just as many Southerners were going north to fight the British, mm-hmm. a lot of slaves were escaping from Southern plantations to go north to fight with the British.
Mm-hmm. So I also think I understand what you're saying is maybe who you want to write about are descendants of somebody who was a soldier,
right,
or people who were soldiers in this war, who were migrated north,
right,
and then went to Canada.
Yeah. So
do you see we're narrowing down from this big, huge subject that could have been a book?
There are two things, though. So women who served the British in various ways, whether it was as maids or cooks or, you know, whatever, were also allowed to go to Nova Scotia as well.
Mm-hmm.
So they moved them too. So it would be, yes, it would be descendants of either soldiers or those women who served the British.
Okay, all right. So we're tightening up our who, right? And so we've got our where. And when was this time frame? When is this time frame we're talking about?
This was in the, the migration was after the armistice was signed in 1776. So the United States became an independent country on July 4th, 1776. The movement of those free slaves started after that point, and if I recall correctly, it may have taken as long as 2 years.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, so we're talking about a time frame. So we're looking for descendants of people who might have migrated in this time frame between about 1776 and 1778.
1778, right.
Okay, all right. So that's the time frame that he's going to be trying to find people who migrated with N. So this gives us a when, even though you're going to interview ancestors who are living today, right?
Right. And there do exist manifest of the slaves who were on those ships.
Okay, and what's a manifest?
A manifest is, airlines do them today. A manifest is simply a list of the passengers. So if you fly from here, you know, to Senegal, the airline has a list of everyone who's on the plane. And, you know, when I flew in from the States, you know, Lufthansa had a list of everybody that's on these. That's a manifest. So in the same way, the British kept the list of everyone who was on those ships that sailed from the United States up to Canada.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So the names of those people are available.
Mm-hmm. So he just told us a couple of hows then. He told us how people migrated on ships, but he also kind of gave us a clue as to how he might conduct some of his research, right?
Yeah.
I would imagine that those manifests might be a really, really important research documents for you.
They would be key research documents.
Yeah, okay. And let's see, you've talked about how, what am I missing? Why, like the why they migrated.
The why they migrated is because in that time the United States was still having its own internal turmoil with slavery. But many of those people had run away from plantations in the South. So in the United States, many of the northern states were free. Massachusetts was a free state. So it had no slavery itself, but there were laws in the United States that said if a Southerner could present papers in a free state that showed that a slave had been their property in the South, that they could reclaim that slave and take that slave back to the South. So that's why many of those slaves wanted to leave, because if I had escaped from a plantation in Georgia, where the city of Atlanta is, where there are lots of Ethiopians, by the way, if I had been a slave on a plantation in Georgia and I had escaped to New York, which was a free state, and I had fought with the British, then if I had remained in the United States, my owner from Georgia could come to New York and say, I have papers that show that Robert is my property, and then could take me back to Georgia. Mm-hmm. So in order to avoid that, people like that would have boarded those ships to go to Nova Scotia.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that's why. So the other why is that I really do, I really would like to show Black Canadians and African Americans that they have, Black Americans, that they have more of a connection than they really understand that
mm-hmm,
they have.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So this sounds like a project that's going to take a lot of research.
A lot of research, right. Yes.
So now I want to, so we've honed down, we haven't honed down completely, like if I'm his editor and we agree he's going to do a story on this subject kind of in this way, I'm going to want him to go do some more research and then come back to me with what he's found, and then we're going to tighten it up even more.
Right.
But this is, would you agree this is kind of enough,
it's enough
honing down for
begin,
you to get
yeah.
started, for us to agree that I like this story idea and how you intend to execute it,
right.
And that you're going to now go do some research and then come back to me so we can tighten it up even further.
Right.
Does that make sense
makes
to you?
Makes sense, yes.
Okay, all right. So I'm also really curious, though, about how he's going to get this information, because I want to make sure that he can actually execute it. It's nice to have this great idea, but as his editor, I'm really concerned about, is this person actually going to be able to do what he's saying that he wants to do?
Right.
So how do you intend to approach this? How are you going to get this information?
The first thing, I believe my first step ought to be to find the logs, the logs that showed who was on the slave ships.
Mm-hmm.
So the way it worked, if you could read and write, they wrote your name and then you signed your name. If you could not read and write, the British wrote your name and then you put a mark there, whatever mark you did, to verify that you were boarding the ship. The logs would also say who disembarked, who actually came ashore in Nova Scotia. So it requires genealogical. So that's the first piece of it, is to get the names of those people who were on those ships, and then the second piece of it becomes genealogical research on both sides of the border.
Mm-hmm. And will you explain to me what genealogical research is?
Genealogical research is basically finding either people from a time period in the past and tracing forward to find out who their ancestors are, or taking someone like me in the present and tracing backwards to find out who my ancestors were, my great-grandparents and their parents and their parents. And a lot of Americans, a lot of Canadians are doing this these days to find out where our foreparents came from. Both, for instance, on my mother's side, I know that one of my great grandfathers was an Englishman who was a blacksmith, and he was free. Because he was an Englishman, and my great grandmother, for whom my mother was named, was a girl that he bought off an auction block and married. So on her mother's side, the Crofts were slaves. Mm-hmm. They were field slaves, and who got involved in the abolitionist movement. And my great-grandfather, Gillum Croft, actually killed a slave overseer for hitting his wife on her shoulder with a whip. And he remained a fugitive until after the Emancipation Proclamation. The Emancipation Proclamation was a law that freed the American slaves. And he remained a fugitive slave until after the slaves were freed. So genealogical research either traces forward a lineage, if you will, or it traces backwards to see who your ancestors are. So that's the kind of research I would have to do.
Okay, good. Let me stop right here. So he told another story within a story, this story about his a great-grandfather who... Wait, he hit him, he killed him, what did he do?
So the Gillum Croft and his wife Rose. My great-grandmother was named Rose. They were field slaves. They worked in the fields. And the overseer, as the story is told in my family, was on a horse.
And what is an overseer?
An overseer is the is an employee of the plantation whose job it is to make sure that the slaves are working hard and doing their job.
And what is his race?
He's white. He's always white.
Okay.
And so he's they're working in the fields picking cotton or whatever. You know, there was a lot of cotton grown in Mississippi. So they're working in the fields picking cotton. The overseer is on a horse. And so the story goes and is told in my family, my great-grandmother, Rose, was tired, and she wasn't picking cotton as fast as the overseer thought she should, and he told her to speed up. And they would have these little whips, and he just hit her across the shoulder with the whip to let her know that he expected her to work harder. And my great,
so that would have hurt a lot,
That would
right?
have hurt a lot,
That
yes.
would have hurt her.
And so my great-grandfather, Gillum Croft, grabbed the whip and pulled him off the horse and put it around his neck and killed him with his bare hands. But then, of course, he's killed this white man, and he says goodbye to my grandmother in the wood, in the fields, and he runs into the woods. And the slaves would sneak food to him in the woods at night.
Uh-huh. Okay. As his editor, that's another really interesting story that he told me, right? Within the context of this big story. So in the back of my mind, I also want him to write that story for me. And actually, since he knows that story, and it doesn't sound to me like that story would require a whole lot of research, I might say, will you write me that story first? Because it's going to take you longer to do this other research. Do you hear that? Do you see how that happened? Okay. Okay. Good. Okay. So let's go back to the research that you need to do for the other project.
Right.
So you're going to look for the ship manifest,
right.
the list of the passengers,
right.
and then you're going to do this genealogical research to start with the manifest. And what will you do? Pick some unusual names that maybe you can trace forward easily, or how will you do that?
Well, what I think I would do is look for names that are sort of common.
Common names.
Common names that are currently common.
Uh-huh.
You know, because if you, for instance, if you, you know, in that same, you know, I talked about the Cross and the Chandlers. If I were looking for descendants of those people, I would look for people with those same last names. I would look, what I mean is to say names in common, not common names. Because if the name is Smith.
Yeah, I was going to tell you, because I have Thomases, it's very hard to research Thomases.
If the name is Smith, there will be too many of those. So what I would look for is people who have names in common with the people who are on the ship. The other question becomes how far back things like birth records, property ownership, business licenses and things like that go.
Right. It sounds to me, unless you're a genealogical expert, that you're going
to
need to work with some experts. Yeah, yeah. So as the editor, I might say, do you know any experts? And he would say yes or no. And I might say, I know some. Here's somebody who I suggest that you talk to. You know, so we can begin sharing resources now. What other research do you imagine you would need to do to write this story?
Well, the other thing, if you can trace ancestry, then you need to find people where they are now,
mm-hmm.
and there are records to find them to find them now. The other thing I would like to find out is, aside from individual family connections, is what these people did in terms of types of work and how they influence a local community, things like that,
mm-hmm.
that I'd like to do some research on. You know, if they carry particular skill sets that they then put to use once they got to Nova Scotia,
mm-hmm.
did they learn the local skill or a local skill or something? And that, I think that also was another way of finding ancestors,
mm-hmm.
as well.
So when you think about this story, this sounds like it will take you a long time to do the research. How, if you had to guess, how long might it take you
to
do your
research? I would think it would take me at least a year to even do the research on the story before I could begin writing.
Mm-hmm. And
And that's provided I can afford the trips to Boston and Nova Scotia.
Right. Okay. Right. So now he's going to need money. right? So now there becomes a question of whether he actually has the resources to do this or where the resources might come from, right? So let's talk resources a little bit.
Well, so what I would likely do to fund the trips is rather than taking my vacations to Puerto Vallarta or Puerto Rico, Puerto Vallarta is in Mexico. It's the big town that almost got hit by the big hurricane that just went to Mexico. It's one of my favorite cities. That I like vacationing there and in Puerto Rico. So rather than going to one of those places for vacation, I would probably use my vacation time, my vacation money, because I work for myself, but use my vacation money to do some of the research.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, I don't know this guy, right? So chances are, as an editor, if I have a budget to fund a project like this, I'm not going to offer it to somebody who I don't know, or if I do, right, maybe I'll just offer him a little bit, because I like what he's talking about. I'm going to ask him soon about what his writing experience is. Actually, if we're having this conversation, I probably already know what his writing experience is, and I've seen some samples of his writing. But I've never worked with him before. There are some writers who we call them flakes. That's not a good term. It's a slang term, but it's not a good term to call somebody. And so there are writers who you give them an assignment and then they disappear and you don't hear from them again. They don't do it, or they half do it, or they turn in. It's a mess when they turn it in. And so these are the people who you don't work with again. But he might flake on me, so I'm not going to invest money in him yet. But if I have a budget and we have a relationship and he's delivered stories and he's done them well in the past, I might at this point in time see if I have some money that might be able to help fund some of his research.
So here's what I'd like to do, because I'm quite serious about this project. Here's what I'd like to do, mm-hmm, is to actually take some of my own money and my own time and do some of that research, because to make sure that there's a story there and I know there's a story there, but to make sure that there's a story that I can tell, that I have the ability to tell, that I have, you know, that even if I get the backing, that I can get the resources to tell, so that when I actually pitch my story to an editor, that I can say that I know that there's a story here. Because for me, and I think this is one of the things I believe it's one of the chances that we take as storytellers, that for me, the story is interesting enough that I would want to know it for myself. Mm-hmm. So if I spent 2 weeks in Boston going through records and then spent another 2 weeks in Nova Scotia going through records, you know, and I would enjoy that process, and then I would enjoy being in those cities for the time that I'm not in the libraries or the archives researching records. Mm-hmm. So I think I would find a lot of personal satisfaction in it, and that becomes part of my motivation, aside from the fact that I really want to tell this story.
Right.
So what I think I would do is take that process, where I take my own time and my own money and do the research to know that there's a real story that I'm able to tell, mm-hmm, that I have the ability to tell before I actually approach an editor with the story.
Okay, good. Now, as you talk about this also sounds like a really long story.
Right.
Right. So as an aside to you, he would not pitch this story to a magazine whose longest stories are this long, right? He would find a publication or a website or some other medium that specializes in longer stories.
Right.
Right. Yeah. I
think I would like to do it as a written piece, but I've also given thought to working with the film documentarian, mm-hmm, and doing it that way. I would like, you know, I'm intrigued by both possibilities because I am a writer.
Yeah.
And I feel more comfortable in that medium. I feel more comfortable in organizing, in digging for facts and organizing for facts. And I'm used to working on big projects alone, mm-hmm, so I don't have to worry about how well I'm able to collaborate with another person. Mm-hmm. But I'm intrigued by the notion of working with a documentarian, a film documentarian, because it broadens my knowledge base. That person could teach me something that I did not already know, if I can find someone who is patient enough to do that.
Right. Well, that's very interesting to me, because my magazine also has a website. And so now I'm thinking maybe there's a chance that we could produce something that we call multimedia. so that maybe it could be in my magazine, it could be on my website, maybe there could be video, maybe, do you have a documentarian in mind?
I don't.
Do you take photographs? Are you a photographer at all?
I take reasonably good photographs, but I know a lot of good photographers who can, as we did in the car, who can help me, who can coach me on what makes a good photograph.
Mm-hmm. So as you do your research, could you take photographs?
I could take photographs.
Would you be interested in taking photographs?
Yeah. And I have a good camera.
You have a good camera. Yeah. Okay, good. So now my mind is thinking, oh, maybe this could be a really interesting project in a number of different media.
It tells me that, too.
It tells you that, too, right. Okay. And when you think about documentary filmmakers, is there anybody who you've worked with or who you know of who comes to mind who might be interested in a project like this?
Yes. Actually, one of my best friends is a documentary filmmaker. She is trying to complete work on a film now. I feel like I would work well with her,
mm-hmm.
in part because we are friends, but we have also been colleagues who work together.
Mm-hmm.
Because friends are not always the best people to work with,
mm-hmm.
you know, and you find that out after you start to work with them. But I have worked with her on projects before because she was a writer before she became a documentary filmmaker.
Okay.
The other reason I want to work with her. In American film, there's an award called the George Foster Peabody Award, and it's like one of the highest awards you can get for filmmaking and television broadcasting, and she has won a Peabody Award.
So now he really has my attention, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she's won a Peabody Award. So we've talked about collaborating on something. And I'm not approached her with this. I've been trying to wait on her to finish the film that she's working on now. She's someone that I have learned from before and that I would feel comfortable continuing to learn from,
mm-hmm.
because I know she's a good teacher.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So this is really, really interesting. Now, let me go back a little bit. I'm going to ask him a question that I probably would have known the answer to, or we would have explored really early on, because I really need to know about his background. And part of what I want to know is, does his background match her background? Like, is he a beginner and she's really accomplished? If she's really accomplished and he's a beginner, chances are that he's not going to be able to work with her. She's not going to want to work with him. She's going to want to work with somebody who's kind of on her level, and who brings something to her that benefits her as well. So can you tell me a little bit about your background? I just need to be comfortable that not only can you deliver this written piece that we're talking about, that you might actually be able to collaborate with this woman who won this Peabody Award.
So I have a lot of experience as a writer.
Mm-hmm.
And pardon me. My writing experience was primarily in writing politics, but I have done lots of long-form journalism.
Mm-hmm. And what is long-form journalism?
Long-form journalism is pieces where you actually do a lot of research, you spend a lot of time talking to people and interviewing people, and then you write a piece that, you know, most news stories run anywhere from 5 to 1,500 words. A long-form piece in journalism speak is 3,500 words.
Mm-hmm.
So I've written lots of pieces like that are intended to explain things to people, and tell them something about paint a picture of a world they didn't know anything about.
Mm-hmm.
And I have television experience,
mm-hmm,
so I've done some script writing.
Okay, good. So now he just told me he has experience writing long stories. Not very many people get to the level where they have an opportunity to write a long story. First of all, there are not that many places anymore, especially that will run a long story. And it's very competitive to get those gigs. People who get those gigs tend to keep them if they're... Oh, a gig is slang for a job. So once people get those jobs, they tend to keep them. They tend to maintain the relationship with the editor. The editor hires their favorite people over and over because the editor wants to make sure that they can trust the person to deliver, to turn in their to turn in their story on time, high quality, without a whole lot of work that the editor needs to do. And since we started out the conversation with who his readers are, I'm interested in somebody who's really going to speak to the interest of my readers. And so this person is really interesting to me as an editor who's meeting somebody new. And so I'm really thinking I want to really work with this person. And I'm going to test him out with this story that he just told me about his about the family experience.
The other thing is now that I've had the conversation with you, is that it could end up either as a magazine piece or as a documentary film. But now that I think about it in the conversation, it could end up as a really good multimedia piece.
Yes. And when you think of a multimedia piece, what are you seeing in your imagination?
I sort of look at it two ways. I think it could be either strictly for web, that it includes a written story, that it includes photographs, graphics, video, charts that explain different things, little information boxes that include historical facts, or it could be what I've done before is where part of it is for a print product, for a magazine or something like that, and the remainder of the project goes on their website. Mm-hmm. So there is a printed story, and everything else, basically you refer the reader to the website for everything else you want to know about the story.
Now, this guy is really interesting to me. As a matter of fact, after we have our meeting, I'm going to go have a conversation with my boss. I'm going to have a conversation with the executive editor or the editor-in-chief of the publication, because this could be something that could be that could generate a lot of revenue for my publication. It's going to take resources from across the organization to help execute it, and so I want my team to know about this. It also makes me wonder whether you might be able to get a grant, or we might be able to get some funding from some other outside entity, some entity outside the publication or outside my organization to help support this as well. That might be something interesting to think about.
Yeah, it is.
So we're going to... Is there anything that I'm missing for the big story that I should ask you about?
I can't think of anything else.
Okay. You guys, you've been listening to this conversation. Are there any questions that come to your mind that if you were in my role as editor, I haven't asked, or that you're curious about? What questions do you have? So how did we meet? How would this have happened?
I would probably have approached someone in a couple of ways. First of all, I would look for some type of publication that I know is going to be interested in the type of story that I want to tell. So if I've already identified my audience, who speaks to that audience? Who circulates to that audience? So if I'm looking for, particularly if I want to cross the board, if I want audience in America, in the United States of America, and in Canada, so I've got to think, what kind of news organization has easy access to an audience in both of those places? Who has access to black people in both of those places, and access to people who are interested in this larger issue of the slave trade in both of those places? So that's the first thing I'm going to look for, and then try to identify those publications, whether it's printed publications or websites or broadcaster or whomever it happens to be. The second thing I'm going to do is if I have never worked with that organization before, what I would do is try to find someone within that organization directly to call. You know, who within that organization, it would likely be someone that could make a decision about whether they want to pay me to do this story. Whether they want to use the story, and then whether they want to pay me to do the story. So that's important. So is because if you approach, if you think I want this story to go to Ebony Magazine, but I don't know anybody at Ebony Magazine, then if I call Ebony Magazine, the switchboard and say, I have a story, they will send me to somebody. But I'm much more likely to get someone to listen to me if I already have a person in mind. I already know who that person is. I already know what kind of editing they do, what kind of stories they're used to hearing about. And I'm even better off if I can find someone that I know who can introduce me to that person. So it's those things. And now from my standpoint, if I'm going to tell this kind of story, and I'm saying this in all seriousness, if I want to tell this kind of story, I want to be the one to tell it. And if I'm going to sell the story to somebody, I actually want to get paid for the work that I'm going to put into it. So before I submit a proposal, I would actually do some of that research that I've been talking about doing, so that I'm far enough along in my project that if the publication is interested in the story, they will say, well, he's too far along for us to reinvest in starting the research over. He already has enough work done that it makes sense for us to pay him to do the rest of, to go ahead with the project. So I want to make it advantageous for them to use me and prohibitive for them to do the work themselves.
Can we dissect that a little bit?
Sure.
What you just said? Okay. So as a practical matter, right? He wants his audience to be Black people in Canada and the United States.
Right.
Robert, what magazines might you pitch to that communicate, that tell stories like this to Black people, either in the United States or Canada or both, as a practical matter, that come to your mind?
Not many except Ebony.
Right. So the fact of the matter is, maybe he has a chance to pitch this to Ebony if we're talking a magazine, right? All right, what if we're not talking a magazine, right? Is there a chance that we could be talking a newspaper? Some newspapers still print some long stories, or on Sunday maybe there's a magazine story. Stories in the inside of the newspaper, there might be a magazine where you can write some longer stories. Do any places come to mind off the top of your head? Or
the New York Times and the Washington Post still do those things. If I were going to try for one of those two, I would probably go after the New York Times, mm-hmm. because they would have, the Washington Post is a very, you know, it's a highbrow, it's a big newspaper, it's a very respected newspaper, but the New York Times has more name recognition, particularly outside the United States,
mm-hmm.
and even in Canada, mm-hmm. you know, because it's sold on newsstands in Canada,
mm-hmm.
and they will do more, they would do more advertising. Their website has a bit of a greater reach,
mm-hmm.
for promoting it,
mm-hmm.
and I would think they would probably be more likely to, mm-hmm. to want to have a conversation about
mm-hmm.
it.
And their website is multimedia.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So for the story that he's describing, there are not a whole lot of places that we can think of off the top of our heads. He might need to do some more research that will run that kind of story. Now, if he wants to tell the story differently as a story that involves a lot of white people, there might be more publications that would be interested. He might even have to tell the story in a way that includes more white people in the United States and Canada, even to get the New York Times interested, right?
Right.
A challenge that he might face with Ebony is, unless I'm mistaken, Ebony probably has one long feature in each issue.
In each issue, yeah.
And Ebony comes out one time a month. So there are 12 Ebony issues, and there are a lot of writers who want that one long story that comes out every month.
Right.
And so this is a really interesting project, and it's a really challenging project.
Right.
Right? Yeah. So this is probably a project he's going to have a lot of personal passion around, because there's some risk here that he may not be able to sell it. He may have to do the preliminary research to do the proposal, right? But be challenged to sell it. And so he would want to make sure that this is something that he wants to learn for himself as well,
right?
I work at Ebony Magazine. I'm busy. Too many people call me. I don't take phone calls.
Right. Well, my way of reaching somebody, Ebony, is that I know somebody who knows the editor at Ebony that I would need to deal with.
Okay, so now he's talking about using his network. How'd you meet that person?
Through the National Association of Black Journalists.
Association of Black Journalists. So in the United States, there's this organization that also happens to be a sponsor of this program, the National Organization of Black Journalists. You want to tell me a little bit about the National Organization of Black Journalists?
The National Association of Black Journalists is just celebrated, which year? Well, let me forego that. The National Association, it's a professional organization of primarily of black journalists in the United States who work in all media, whether it's newspaper people, online, television, radio, people who work in documentary filmmaking, people who work in public relations. So its primary role, it has two primary roles. One is professional development, to make sure that we have the skills to compete at different levels. And the other is advocacy for black journalists and for the black point of view in news stories. A lot of the work that they do is to try to get news organizations, particularly big ones, to hire black journalists, which is still a challenge sometimes. So that's what it does. It has regional meetings, but it has one big annual conference every year, which this year was in Minneapolis, and which next year is in Washington, D.C., where there are a lot of Ethiopians, if you have family, you know. Be a good time to come. The conference is next year in Washington, D.C. It's because of the economy and a lot of other things, it doesn't draw as many people as it used to. These days, it draws about 1,500 people. In its greatest years, it drew about 3,000 people. But it's still very active and very vibrant. The association was originally started as a way to advocate for black journalists getting jobs in newsrooms. And some of the original founders are still alive. But the other thing is that's the organization's purpose. But as a member, you go both for the professional development and because it's an opportunity to meet people from all around the country who do different kinds of work and that you can collaborate with or learn from or connect with in some way that they can help you do something or you can help them do something, work together on projects and all kinds of things like that.
Yeah. So remember our Michelle Obama conversation from yesterday? So as you develop in your careers, you are going to be each other's best network. Right? And you will network with each other and build a community of people who you will be able to call over the course of your careers. And so now you're starting to have, or you may already have, because you may have family in other places, relationships internationally. And so as you grow and develop, you're going to cultivate them, you'll maintain them. And so that's a very important piece. But I still, I don't pick up the phone. I understand in this particular case, he knows somebody who knows somebody at Ebony, so he can get to me because I like that person. But what if you didn't know anybody at Ebony Magazine? How might you find somebody? How might you find who the appropriate editor is to pitch? Or it could even be at a newspaper. How would you find who the appropriate editor is?
Well, one of the things about news organizations tend to be very transparent about who covers what and who edits what, because they want both sources to be able to find those people, they want newsmakers to be able to find those people, and in the cases where they do buy things from people, they want freelancers to be able to find them as well. So it just takes, sometimes it takes a few phone calls, mm-hmm. but you can make enough phone calls that you find out who the person within the organization is. And if I don't know that person, then for me, there are any number of ways to try to approach them. You know, my first inclination is to try to go directly to that person. You know, if that doesn't work, I tend to try to make my way around some subordinate, a reporter who knows them, perhaps that I know, a secretary. Mm-hmm. You know, which
always be nice to the administrative people.
Yes.
Be nice to the help. Be nice to the janitor. Be nice to the secretary, because these are people who can help you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I learned that very early in my career. But Yeah, so I would sort of look for people mm-hmm. at whatever level who I can have a conversation with, who then can pass me on to the next person.
Yeah, yeah. Another really good place to look is, are you familiar with the term masthead? In every magazine or in a newspaper, in a publication, in the beginning, you'll see long lists of names, and it'll say that this person is the features editor, this person is the health editor, this person is the politics editor. And so you can look through and see names. And then sometimes you can do a guessing game about their email, which we can talk about in a separate conversation. But say my magazine is Hilary Magazine, the email might be, you know, HilaryBeard@HilaryMagazine.com or something kind of like that. And so if you really have to be creative, you might play with a couple of configurations of email addresses and see if something gets through.
Although a lot of American newspapers are publishing the names and publishing the email addresses.
And lots of times they're on the website, or lots of times there's a contact page on a website.
Right.
And so it may have the writer's guidelines, the freelance writer's guidelines on the website, and it might say who to contact for different things.
But one thing I do know in pitching a story to anybody is the less they know about me, the more refined I want to make my pitch and the more information I want to provide them.
Right. And so that kind of gets to the second question that you asked, is what if you're a beginner writer? What if you're beginning? How do you convince that editor that you're somebody to take a risk on? Which is, if I'm the editor and you're a new writer to me, and especially if you're a beginning writer, to me, I'm thinking of you as a big risk, right? And so one is, I don't know how good a writer you are, right? And so in this particular case with Robert, I would have the opportunity to look at his writing samples, or clips, C-L-I-P-S, clips we call them. And so I would have seen his clips before, and that would give me confidence. And so ways that you guys can build clips are by writing for smaller publications. So what you want to do is begin a process of building a library of clips. And so you can start with a small publication. You can start with a school newspaper or a community newspaper or a newsletter that you write for. Or there are all sorts of different ways to write small. Or a website, write pieces for a website. And you're going to use each piece that you create to kind of to leverage your way to a better publication. So you'll start with small publications or with publications that aren't particularly well known or particularly influential, and then you'll approach the next level of publication and say, this is the work that I've been able to do. And so when you're a beginner, you don't want to start out by pitching too high. You want to pitch at the level you're at, or pitch a level above where you are, because you're trying to work your way up. There's going to be a process of working your way up. Do you want to add anything to that?
One thing I would say is whatever level you are, you can always write. If you're a college student, you can write. If you are a freelance journalist, you can write. But I have recruited and hired a lot of journalists in my career. I have never recruited and certainly not hired one who did not have some work samples to show me. And that's really important, that you have something to show me. The other thing that always impresses, whether I was hiring somebody or hiring a freelancer, is how unique and how fresh, and Americans use that term a lot, your ideas are, how different your ideas are and how unique they are. And the third thing is the understanding that you have of my news organization and what we do. Mm-hmm. Because I cannot tell you, I worked for the Associated Press for a long, long time, and I cannot tell you how many young journalists would come to me and I would say, tell me what you know about the Associated Press. And they didn't know anything about the Associated Press. And frankly, at that point, in my mind, the conversation is over. Because I feel like if you haven't taken the time, you know, to learn something about my organization before you try to sell yourself or your work to me, then it just says that you're not prepared. And so you want to go prepared. You want to say, I, you know, at whatever level it happens to be, I have work that I can show you that I'm proud of. I have really good ideas, and I know what your organization is and what you do and who you serve.
And can I add another piece?
Yes.
If you want to be really smart, know his work.
Yeah.
Be able to talk to him about stories he's written or awards that he's gotten or know what he's known for, right? And you might even want, since he works for the Associated Press, there might even be some writers who you really like and whose work you follow who also work for the Associated Press who you can impress him by talking about, that you know their work.
Okay, first person means that I'm writing about my own experience. And most stories you see, it talks about, you know, what we've been talking about. I'm the storyteller. I have this person's, this is the person whose story I'm telling. This is my audience. Well, in first person, I'm telling my own story. Okay, so in news.
So can I add a thought to that? So anytime you see a story told and it says, I did this, or I, right, that's first person.
So in news, it is acceptable in many instances to tell a story from your own experience, as long as you have been involved in something that is of interest and is noteworthy in some way. For instance, when I was a young reporter, my first year out of college, I covered a hurricane. And my newspaper had never done that in a way that I had. They had always covered them from a distance. And I went down to the Gulf Coast and I spent the night in the hurricane. And so they asked me to write a first person piece about what it's like to spend the night in a hurricane. Because, you know, we lived inland and the storms would come up and the wind would blow, but it wasn't the same as being there when the storm came in off the water. So I wrote a piece about that. So yes, I can write a piece about my family's history. And in a case like that, there is no pretense that it's an objective piece. It is intended to be a factual piece to the extent that I can make it. But it's not intended to be an objective piece. And we sort of explain that to our readers when we do this. And there's something in journalism called an editor's note. And usually in this type of piece, we write an editor. Does anybody not know what an editor's note is? Okay, so an editor's note is just one or two sentences, usually one sentence, that explains the circumstances under which this story was written, because they are special circumstances. So in the case of me having spent the night in the hurricane, the editor's note would say, Robert Naylor spent the night in Hurricane Frederick. This was his first time spending the night in a hurricane, and it explains that. So we would do something like that with that kind of story, that Robert Naylor is writing this story about his own ancestors, and something to that effect. So yes, you can do that. Now the first thing is if I pitch a story to someone and they reject it, there's either of two things that I can do, and I can either refine my pitch, I can change my pitch to fit what they want, or I can take it someplace else. Now in my case, and I think it depends on how confident you are as a journalist, in my case it depends on how strongly I feel about what I'm doing. And, as to whether, but most of the times, generally speaking, when I have talked to editors about stories that I wanted to do, most editors are not trying to stop you from doing a story. Their goal is, now there are editors who say, I'm not interested in that story, and you move on with it. But if an editor says to me, you know, I like that, but what if we, you know, took the story in a different direction, that rather than, we just found one person and followed, you know, something, you know, if they help. So it may be that they, go ahead.
So I like your story, but for my audience, it's a little bit different from your audience that you're describing. And so for my audience, I'm really interested in that, but I'm really more interested in the white person who owned the ship who took the black people from the southern United States to Canada. And so I'm wondering, as you tell the story, I really want to focus in on the white man who owned the ship.
So my response to that would be, I think that could be what we call a sidebar. It could be a separate story that's part of the package. And if the editor did not accept that, he said, no, I don't want it to be a sidebar. The term sidebar means that it's a separate story that refers back to the bigger story.
And it might run alongside.
Where the name came from, sidebar, runs alongside of it. But if the editor said to me, no, that's not what I want. I want the story about the owners of the ship. Then I would say, that's not the story I want to tell. And I would go elsewhere.
And I bring that up because sometimes as African-American journalists, I mean, it's not unusual as African-American journalists for us to be interested in telling a story from a black perspective, but there are not a whole lot of black editors. And so we may have to pitch this to somebody who doesn't necessarily share our interest in our heritage or our history or our story. And so some of these are the challenges that we face that might, not necessarily, but might be similar to challenges that you might face pitching into the Western media or trying to tell your story into the Western media. You may find somebody coming back at you with their view of how the story should be told or could be told that may or may not be comfortable based on how you want to tell it.
I first heard about the story in 2011. In 2011, 4 years ago. That's 4 years ago, right? Yeah. I heard about the story first in 2011. I was on a business trip to Montreal, Montreal is also a very diverse city. Montreal is a bilingual city in that there are a lot of French speakers and there are a lot of English speakers, but the primary language in Montreal is French. And so I was stumbling around and trying to make my way in French. I used to speak a little bit of French. And there was this guy, I was in a restaurant, and he spoke up and ordered for me. You know, he was at the table next to me, and I thanked him for that, but he started speaking, and clearly English was his first language. And so I said, are you an American? And he said, no, I'm from Nova Scotia. And we were sitting there just in, you know, he was finishing his, so we actually sat and we chatted for the longest time, and I said to him, I didn't know there were any black folks. I knew there were black folks in Montreal, and I knew there were black folks in Toronto, and that's where the majority of them are in Canada. But I didn't know there were any black folks in Nova Scotia. And he said to me, oh yeah, there are. And he starts to recount the story to me of how the American slaves were brought to Nova Scotia afterwards, and he was descended from American slaves. And so I thought, well, that's a fascinating story. And I went back and I read a little bit about it and never really did anything about it. I just thought it was fascinating. And so earlier this year, there was this television series and it was actually not the focus of the television series, but the television series focused on a lot of aspects of the slave trade from West Africa to America, including how other Africans captured, how Africans captured other Africans to sell to Europeans to take to the Americas. So, but at the very end of the show, they were showing these people signing this book, and the show is called The Book of Negroes. And so what they did was they signed this book when they boarded the ship. And I said, that's what he was, and I remembered that conversation, and I got really interested in it all over again, and so I started to read up about it. So the truth of the matter is, I don't have a lot of knowledge about the subject. It's just something I'm really curious about, and that I really would like to explore, but I also feel like at this point I've learned enough about it that it's a story that I'd like to tell, in large part because I don't feel a lot of people know a lot about that, particularly African Americans. So in terms of resources, I really don't believe I can sell that story without doing some research on my own and really going with a much better formed idea, which is actually one of the reasons this, you know, even though we're modeling something for you, it actually has been very good for me. I don't believe I can go to any kind of news organization, whatever it is, or, you know, I mean, there are places that I could see if we did a film that I could sell it to, places that would be interested in it. But I don't believe I can go to them with what I have right now. I believe that I have to have much more information. And so for me, I do have some resources to do the research, but it's basically diverting resources from someplace else. So, sorry. So for me, because I like tropical climates and I like water and beaches and things like that. And that's where I usually tend to take vacation. So I tend to go to beach communities for vacations. And so rather than do that, I would take the money that I would pay for a vacation and go to Boston and then go to Nova Scotia to do research and spend my vacation doing the research. That's where I would get the resources. But I really, with the goal of having a much better and much better developed idea about the story that I want to tell, because right now it's not much more than an idea. My experience has been that that editors who show an interest in your story are really going to try to figure out how to formulate it in a way that their audience is going to be interested in the story. And you then see more of this kind of a process. But we're not trying to say this is a structure that you will use. What we're trying to say is here is a way that you need to formulate your own thinking. You need to know when you go in the door, here's the story that I want to tell. And you need to know enough about the organization that you're trying to sell your story to, or that particularly if it's Western media, that you understand what it is that they want. And the other thing is one of the things that Hilary pointed out, if you're trying to sell stories to Western media, in large part, very often, when you're trying to tell a story from a perspective that you understand, they are going to want to tell the story from a different perspective. And you kind of have to understand, is this where I want to go with my story? Because the simple truth is, and I was telling them we'll get to this a minute ago.
Slow down.
Oh, that's right. I got to slow down. I'm sorry. One of the things that they tend to do in American media, and even in theatrical films, is that they will take a black story and tell it from a white perspective. There is a movie, and if you can find it anywhere, it's called Mississippi Burning. It is one lie from the beginning to the end. I find the movie offensive. Because
he's from Mississippi.
I'm from Mississippi.
He would know.
So it's a movie called Mississippi Burning, and you probably can find it somewhere. But the movie is about the civil rights struggle in Mississippi. In Mississippi, there were three civil rights workers who were killed, and the FBI came in to investigate the killers. One of them was black. Two of them were white. There were two Jewish men young Jewish men from New York. They were in Mississippi trying to get people registered to vote, and they were murdered by white people, and they were buried in a dam. And if you believe this movie, black people in Mississippi were scared to death. They were running away constantly. Every white person who lived in Mississippi was evil, and the great savior was the FBI. It is a lie, and I find that movie absolutely offensive, because it's completely untrue. But those are the people who had the money and they control the medium. And that's why we have to learn to tell our own stories. So much of the time when you start to pitch a story, they will want to tell your story from a white perspective. And you have to decide whether you're willing to do that.
Yeah, and so I raise that because as African Americans, there are way more white editors than there are African American editors, and this is a challenge that we face. Every day, right? And so if you want to do international journalism into the United States or Western Europe, and expect that you will encounter this at least sometimes. It may happen to you never. If it doesn't, you're very fortunate. It may also happen to you often. So that's why I asked him that question. So thank you for your question that inspired it. Also, can I add to what you were saying?
Please.
So this conversation that Robert and I were having, so I work for myself, and I work with people almost entirely over the internet. I've never had that conversation with somebody in person. Right? So in sharing this with you, I want you to know that conversation is a conversation that I have in my head or that I have with myself to get my proposal or my pitch letter together. So I have to answer the who, what, where, when, why, how in my pitch letter to somebody. And I have to convince them that if I'm new to them, I need to convince them that I'm worth the risk that they're taking to hire me rather than a writer that they already know, because a magazine only has a certain number of slots and they already have relationships with people. They have to trust that I'm gonna be able to do it well, that I'm not gonna turn in a story to them that's a disaster and makes them do a lot of work to have to edit it. They need to trust that I can turn it in on time. Deadlines, turning things on time is really important. And then when they come back to me with questions, they have to be able to trust that I'll go get the answers to those questions or those queries quickly and get it back to them. Because their publication, whether it's a newspaper or a magazine or a website, they're on a schedule. So they're counting on me to get it to them so they can edit it so that they can then turn it over to the next person who might be a fact checker who's going to go through and check the facts of the piece. We'll talk about that in coming days. And then maybe there's a top editor or a copy editor who's making sure that my grammar and punctuation are correct. So there are other people who are waiting, and there are lots of stories that they're juggling, so they have to trust me to do what I say I'm going to do.
And if I can add one thing, I work for myself now too, but I spent the first 34 years of my career working in news organizations. And that is exactly the kind of conversation you have. It is, and when I became an editor, much of the time reporters would come to me with story ideas that are just that broad, you know, and my job as an editor is to get them to bring this big thing into something that's manageable. And so you have those conversations with people. And what I would say to you is that don't discount the fact that you might be able to do something like that. Now, the Associated Press, as a for instance, has a bureau of some kind in every country in Africa. And the people who run the bureau are almost always Americans, with a few exceptions. The chief of Africa services is actually a Namibian woman. She's based in Johannesburg now, but she started as a stringer. So the other people who work for the Associated Press across Africa are Africans. And so don't discount the fact that you might be able to work for a news organization. And if you do, that's the kind of conversation you will have, because the people you are writing for are not necessarily Africans.
And so also I want to say that I was very direct in asking the ladies if they have questions. And so the reason I was direct in asking that, and I'm going to continue to be for a while, is because, if I understand correctly, the reason that you all are in this program is because you want to do work internationally, right? If I were trying to do work here, I would need to adjust my mannerisms or make some adjustments for the culture here. As women, if you want to do work internationally, and particularly in the West, you're going to have to stand up, ask questions, and jockey with men who are trying to get the same story that you're trying to get. And they're trying to provide for their family like you're trying to provide for your family. And so there's some standing up for yourself in that process and making sure that your voice gets heard and that you don't get talked over, that you don't get cut off, that you don't get marginalized and pushed to the back. It might require behaving a little bit differently than you might normally, but I want to give you the opportunity to practice, because to succeed in international journalism, that's some of what you're going to need to do. So that's why I'm making a point out of that.
And I would say, ladies, do speak up, because part of the reason that I want you to speak up is because as a journalist and as an editor, I see too few women's voices in the media. You know, women ask different questions often about how things affect people because they have different life experiences. You know, people of color ask different questions than white reporters. You know, reporters from different regions of the world or different regions of the country ask different questions. And if you don't condition yourself to put yourself out there and ask those questions, they will never be answered. Because As an American and as a man, I would never ask the same questions that you would. I might ask some of the same questions, but I would not ask you across the board the same questions that you would. There are lots of questions in American media that have to do with about
what Americans talk a lot about is work-life balance. And when we report about business...
Will you explain what that is?
Work-life balance basically suggests that, in the years past, Americans, you know, a lot of us believe we have to work hard. We have to work hard. We have to work hard, right? You know, we're taught that. I was taught that. But particularly as women came into the workforce, they said, you know, I have another side to my life. I have a family. And in America these days, men have finally started to say, you know, I have another side to my life, and it's my family. And I don't want to spend all of my time at work. And so I need time for work, and I need time for family. And that's what in America has become, and actually much, not only America, and much of Western Europe and Australia, even into India, where people are talking about work-life balance, where work is an important part of my life, but my family and my friends and my pastime and my personal time are as important to me too. Mm-hmm. So the first people who raised that as a question in the United States were women. And if women had not started that conversation, it would never have become a part of our conversation at all. Mm-hmm. You know, women invent things differently. I'll leave it at this. In America, you drive up to buy gasoline for your car. Now, I live in New Jersey where we don't pump our own gasoline because we're special. But in most of America, you drive up and you pump your gasoline. You don't go in the store to pay. You stick a credit card in the machine, and it authorizes, and then you pump your gasoline. A woman introduced that. A woman invented that. And when she first proposed it to Exxon, she was the only woman on the team. And they didn't think it made any sense. Except if you're a woman and you've got three kids in your car, you don't want to have to go in to pay for gasoline. So that's what I mean. So just as she affected an invention, you can affect conversations. And so that's why we're trying to, you know, I don't want to make anybody feel uncomfortable. I really don't want to make you feel uncomfortable. I just want you to ask questions that these men will not ask.
Well, I kind of do want to make you feel uncomfortable sometimes, because when we grow, growth involves being willing to feel at least a little bit uncomfortable.
Which I've done many times.
Yeah, so I don't want to make you feel like way uncomfortable, but all of us, to get the kind of opportunities you want, you're going to need to come out of your comfort zone. Being here, even though I'm standing in front of the room, sitting in front of the room, being very authoritative with you, in a lot of ways, I'm way out of my comfort zone, right? You probably can't see this, but I actually feel very shy, right? So I want to suggest to you that there are all sorts of stories. In the Western media, men's stories, we hear them all the time. They're overtold. Mm-hmm. They're told over and over and over again, right?
Largely white men's stories.
Largely white men's stories. They're television shows, they're magazines. You go through them, it's white men's stories. Turn the page, another white man's story, another white man's story, another white, you know, or another white person's story. There's nothing wrong with white people as human beings. That's not the point that I'm making. The point that I'm making is that our stories are missing. And so as women, as Ethiopians, what you uniquely have to bring, the thing that's going to make you different from everybody else, is you're a woman telling a woman's story. An Ethiopian woman telling a Ethiopian woman's story in a Western publication. That's really interesting. There are not many of those.
And let me explain how it looks a little bit. So I worked for many years in Washington, I worked for a number of years in Washington, D.C., and so I told you I covered the presidential campaign, but I covered two other things. But my biggest assignment beyond that was covering what they call labor, covering issues about work. And every month, the United States, the government, comes out with figures that tells the percentage of people who are looking for jobs but who don't have jobs, okay? So it'll be, you know, 5.7% of people are unemployed. And so as a labor reporter for the Associated Press, I was covering this statistic, and people were talking. So this was in the 90s, and it was a point at which the unemployment rate had been high, and it started to come down. You know, it had been way up in very high numbers. Bill Clinton got elected president, and then unemployment rates started coming down. Much the way that Barack Obama got elected president, and the unemployment rate started to come down. And so people are telling that same story now. The unemployment rate is coming down. Except when I was covering that statistic back in the 1990s, when I opened a couple of pages into the report, what I found is that white people were getting jobs and black people weren't. Well, I was the only black reporter covering that issue. And so, because the Associated Press had a black reporter covering that issue, the Associated Press was the only news organization reporting at that time that even though the overall unemployment rate was coming down, African Americans were not getting jobs, which is largely true today. The unemployment rate for African Americans today is twice what it is twice the national average, and it's more than twice what it is for white people. And so the story was very similar when I was covering it, but the Associated Press initially was the only news organization reporting that because they had a black reporter. No one cared about that as much as I did. And this is the whole issue. So if a woman reporter may have looked and said, you know, because they break the statistics down this way, well, men are getting jobs, but women are not getting jobs. And that's the kind of thing so that's the perspective that you bring. And nobody believes it when I say this, but there was a time in my life when I was very shy too. I really was. And nobody believes it because I'm not shy anymore. But I had to take myself outside my comfort zone because I would be at news conferences and I'm trying to wait my turn to ask a question and everybody else is getting their question in and I'm leaving the news conference and I didn't get to ask a question. And I finally decided the only way I'm going to get to ask a question, and in American journalism, they do this thing called group hits where a politician will be standing out on the streets and everybody runs up and tries to get their question in first, right? And so I got to be really aggressive. And I'm, you know, and I could go in and elbow people out of the way, you know, and all kinds of things to be at the front to get my question asked and answered. And this was the shy boy from Mississippi doing this. It's not the way. I grew up to be very deferential, to give people space, to be polite. None of this was polite. But I was standing on the steps of City Hall in New York City covering a presidential candidate when a guy said to me, if you don't move out of the way, and then he used some profanity, and I said, you try, and we'll see what happens. That the boy from Mississippi years before would never have said that. And so that's coming outside your comfort zone. But because of that, I became a better journalist. Now, you know, I can go home and be that same boy from Mississippi. But when I'm out on the streets, I can run with the best of them. I really would like for you to work on your pitches, and we've had some people volunteer to do this, but I'd like for some different people to volunteer, because I think some of you are getting it, but I would like to hear from some people that we haven't heard from before, and particularly some women, who can come up in front of the class and sit with Hilary and me and go through this sort of exercise, because we want you to be able to refine your thinking and talk about with an international editor from a Western news organization, here's a story that I have that you need. That's what we want to do. So everybody's supposed to have a story idea. So go home and try to be able to come back tomorrow and answer those kinds of questions. And we know that we can only do two or three people, but I want, if we do three people, I would like for two of them to be women.
Ooh, nice. I like him. Okay, good. And I just wanted to mention, a couple of people asked about the publications we were talking about. So I put their websites. So Ebony Magazine is a lifestyle magazine about mostly African-American life, but black life. They do some international stories every now and then. And Essence Magazine is a magazine for women. So that's, I think that's Essence's magazine. But you can Google it, you can search it and find it. And then the third magazine, BlackEnterprise.com, is actually a business magazine. And I actually haven't looked at it for a minute, but they used to run travel stories,
they
right?
They do run travel
they
stories.
They still run travel stories. Yes. So there might be an opportunity to talk about that.
And
economic development.
That's what I was about to say.
Right.
Run stories about economic development, especially on the African continent.
Yes. So you have one of the fastest growing economies. That might be some place you want to prepare yourself to eventually pitch an economic development story, or a story about businesses here, or about business organizations, or maybe about a women's business cooperative. So those are organizations. And then I also wrote the name of this movie that makes Robert so mad, because it took a story where black people were at the center and pushed black people to the periphery and made white people the heroes. So that movie is called Mississippi Burning. But almost every story that's done by Hollywood that is a black story pushes black people to the periphery, and there's a white person who saves the day, whether in real life the person who saved the day was white or not.